Would you be open to the possibility that you're not a fraud? That you already have what it takes and that you have so much to offer? Welcome, my name is Nitya Shanti. And today I'm going to be talking about a lesson that changed everything for me. I was living in a forest monastery in Northeast Thailand. I'd been living there for several months. My teacher had built a new meditation hall. And after mopping and sweeping it, which was my duty during the day, I sat on the veranda outside and I was practicing meditation. The form of meditation I was practicing is called Metta Bhavana, loving kindness. And in this practice, you generate a sense of loving wishes for yourself, for the people around you, for the acquaintances you have, the neutral people in your life, including the people that you don't even like in your life. Loving wishes for all. And the aim is to practice this kind of loving friendliness, loving kindness, until you have equal love and regard for all these sets of people in the same way. And I've been practicing this, and I had kind of hit a wall in my practice. And it just felt I was going through the motions, but nothing real was happening. So I felt frustrated, and I stopped. That evening, we had evening chanting, and after about an hour or so of chanting, I went to my room and I had some recordings of my teacher's talks. So I played one of these recordings. And it happens like this. I'm sure you've had this experience as well, where sometimes you have a burning question and in an unexpected way, you get the answer. So almost like he was speaking to me, my teacher said in that talk that when you find you are unable to love, then love your inability to love. I found that such a powerful thought. Wow, love my inability to love. So right there, I put aside that tape recorder and I just sat and I said, all right, if I can't practice this, I will love my inability to practice this. Because to love is to let be. To love is to embrace things and people exactly the way they are. Not once they become okay, then we'll embrace them. That would be comparison. That would be evaluation, that would be judgment. Perhaps this is what the Gita refers to when it says, do your work and don't worry about the outcomes. Karam kar, phal ki ichha mat kar. Put all the effort into the process. And as I let go of the outcome, there was a complete shift in my perception. There was a complete shift in my state of being. I realized this is not limited to only love. For example, discipline. If I have a self-judgment, I'm not disciplined enough. I need to find the places in my life I am disciplined. For example, I'm very disciplined about breathing. I've never stopped. I'm very disciplined about getting some sleep at night. I'm very disciplined to eat when I'm hungry. There are many places in my life I'm disciplined. I'm disciplined about wearing some clothes when I leave my house. I've never walked out naked. So you look for places in your life that you are disciplined. And as I appreciate my current level of discipline, my self-perception changes. I once had a lady contact me. She wrote me a message on Facebook. And she said, Nitya, I am going through a really difficult period in my marriage. I don't think I can survive this marriage. And she went on to share the whole situation that had happened. And at the end, she signed off saying, I'd love to hear from you. And I'd love your advice. Just don't tell me to forgive him. So my response to her was, that's all right. Can you forgive yourself for your inability to forgive him? Forget about forgiving him. You forgive yourself. If it's truly not your fault, if truly you're that innocent, then why should you be carrying so much baggage within yourself? Forgive yourself for your inability to forgive him. She met me 2 years later. I had a retreat in Bali. And she said the reason she's here is those few words completely shifted it for her. And she began focusing on self-forgiveness, self-acceptance. And as the war within her settled down, she was able to see things from a new perspective. And she'd able to come to some kind of resolution in that aspect of her life. So can I be grateful for my current level of gratitude? Can I be contented with my current level of awakening, enlightenment? Can I love my present level of knowledge? What happens when I do that? There's something known as imposter syndrome, where even in the top colleges of the world, students feel that they don't belong. It's like a secret thought. I don't belong here. I'm not good enough. Everybody else got in here through merit. I've gotten here by accident. I don't really belong here. This is found in Ivy League colleges. It's found all across the world. In top professions, psychologists will tell you, people come to them confessing, I don't feel I belong here. And the sense of I'm not good enough, if people really knew, then they wouldn't respect me, love me for who I am. And so I've got to put up this facade, this mask. This becomes a huge burden, a baggage to carry. I like to say that, you know, scientists tell us the universe is what, 13.6, 13.8 billion years old? So if it's taken that long for this moment to get created, who am I in 30, 40, 50 years of life experience to say, it's not good enough? Oh, really? How do I know? Sometimes people appreciate me, say, Nitya, how is it possible? At such a young age, you know all of these things. It's quite interesting because from my perspective, it must mean that maybe in a previous incarnation, I was very lazy. So now at a young age, I know all of these things. You don't have to believe in all of these things. It's just a way of thinking. So it's important to meet ourselves where we are, embrace ourselves where we are. Amor fati, to fall in love with your fate exactly the way it is. What if nothing's out of place? I was invited to give a talk in Utah, and there was a big gathering at a church. And as I was sitting there, I actually had no clue what I was going to talk about. I just walked toward the back of the room, and there was a large window, and there was wind blowing outside, and these trees were dancing in the wind. All the leaves were dancing in the wind. And it occurred to me, the dance of every leaf is perfect. No leaf has to match the dance of any other leaf. So the powerful perception that arose is, what if this is the most perfect moment of my life? So that is what my talk was about that evening. What if this is the most perfect moment of my life? What evidence do I have it's not? Apart from my comparisons. One of my teachers would say, when you think nothing is happening, that's when the most is happening. And when you think a lot is happening, often not much is happening. In other words, we are very poor judges of our own progress. And comparison is quite meaningless. This morning, I had a friend of mine send me a poem. I liked it so much, and I felt it's very relevant to what I'm going to talk about right now. So I asked her for permission to share it with all of you. Her name is Nandini Sen, and she's written several books. So let's read this poem out to you. It goes like this. Not everyone has the luxury of a slow life or mindfulness or avocado. Many live paycheck to paycheck, which is often not enough. They are fighting. They are tired. Not everyone can show up for full moon meditation sessions surrounded by healing crystals and a singing bowl. They sleep spent to their bones or watch mindless comedies until they do. They also snack on things with too much sugar or salt or fat. It comforts them. Not everyone can find the willpower to exercise. They can barely push themselves to shower. Their heads and hearts and minds all hurt. Their brain fogs up. Their limbs don't seem to listen. Their clothes don't fit, and they cannot afford new ones. They sleep poorly. They cry often. Success is a day they did not get fired. They need that job because they have dependents. Who think they are superheroes? Not everyone can play nice all the time. Life has been cruel to many, and they don't know why. They lash out, they are unreasonable, they are petty, greedy, they are hurting. Not everyone has had the same life, even people you have known as children. their life has taken them into places you cannot fathom. And they haven't told anyone. They are doing what they can with what they have and what they are doing without. We may not understand. We may think we would be different. We would act different, better, if we were in their shoes. But we are not. And this is a poem by Nandini. And Nandini says, as a little note to me at the end, she says, "The irony that I wrote this sitting in the terrace suite of the Shangri-La Hotel is not lost on me." So we are where we are, and we are as privileged as we are, and we are as desperate as we are. And can we meet ourselves where we are? Can we hold our privilege lightly and also our desperation lightly, not tightly? There's a beautiful teaching that the Sufi is totally content with simple clothes, simple food, simple dwelling. The simplest of the simple will do. But when the king invites the Sufi to teach, the Sufi cannot accept a seat that is lower than the king's, cannot accept food that is less refined as the king's. Because in that moment, the Sufi represents the divine. The Sufi has to have the high seat. He has to have the finest clothes and the finest food. And I love that story because it shows that not to be attached to any aspect of your life. Wherever you go, there you are, and show up according to the context. Don't get caught up in your identities. We can do things for joy, or we can do things from joy. We can do things for happiness, or we can do things from happiness. We can do things for peace, or we can do things from peace. The lesson that changed everything is, whatever the final aim is of your work, of your family life, of your spiritual life, of any aspect of your life, whatever the final endpoint that you're seeking is, make that the beginning point. Begin with end in mind. Start there. Let that be your foundation. So that evening, sitting in my hut, listening to my teacher, a beautiful revolution happened in my consciousness where I realized it was not about seeking anything. It was about being it. It was not about matching some arbitrary idea of how my consciousness should be. It was about awakening to the fact that all states of consciousness are always already available. Focusing on the process, not on the output or the outcome. So this is what I wanted to share with you, and I hope some of it was meaningful for you. Thank you, and we'll see you again. What if the opposite of what I believe is also true in some way? Very powerful question. Sometimes we get into a rut because of what we've been told. For example, we've been told success comes through hard work. And we've heard it so often. And we forget that actually success also comes from hard work. Can we define success on our own terms and not just what society expects? So we don't remember what people say. We remember how they make us feel. We don't care what people know until we know that they care. So the real shift in any case is a shift in the heart. That's where the transformation happens. When the voice and the vision on the inside gets louder than the voices and opinions on the outside, that's when you mastered your life. So in this course, I'd like you to get into a way of thinking about life where you regularly challenge what you believe to be true. While it's wonderful and supportive to have values, it's also tremendously freeing to, from time to time, drop the values. But any value is going to narrow your scope of how you experience yourself and your world. And it's nice to take a holiday from that once in a while. So I've put together some of my favorite contra wisdom in this course. And for me, there have been significant shifts, each and every one of them. And I'm sure you'll find something here that challenges your way of looking at the world and gives you a new perspective on life. There's a lovely quote by Mary Oliver, the wonderful poet, and she says, "Wouldn't God be disappointed if we're not dazzled by this existence at least 10 times a day?" It's an invitation to step out of the history and into the mystery. And that's what Contra Wisdom promises to do. Join me on Round Glass where we go against the grain of what we think we know.